Welcome to a new edition of the Neon Jazz Interview Series with European jazz drummer and composer Snorre Kjerk. He opened up about his latest 2019 CD called Beat. This album is an eclectic mix of exotic rhythms and vivid, colorful compositions, and it proves his long tenure on the European jazz scene as a sideman with some of the biggest and finest names on the Scandinavian jazz scene. It all began in 2012 with his CD Blues Modernism that got the prestigious Jazz Special Award in Denmark for Album of the Year, as well as receiving two nominations in the Danish Grammy Awards. And he has a link to Kansas City, being a part of the Kansas City Art of Swing Festival. He opened up about this and so much more, so please get to know him and dig this interview, my friends.
Let's go ahead and dive right in here and talk about your latest CD, Beat. It's a mix of exotic rhythms, colorful compositions. Talk to me about kind of your aim with this project.
I mean, well, the aim with it is, I've been running the more or less the same band for quite a while, 5-6 years. I would say it's a continuation of the process of writing very specifically for that band and for the soloists in that band, and writing music that is fitting to the individual players and the way they present themselves from their best sides, I would suppose.
Before we get into kind of the beginnings of your life, you have a history in Kansas City. Talk to me about that.
Yeah, that's one of the more strange coincidences in my musical career, at least. But that was sort of the brainchild and love child of Henrik Iversen, who was the chairman of the Danish Ben Webster Foundation. He was a close friend of Ben Webster when he lived in Copenhagen. So between him and Anita Dixon of the Mutual Musicians Foundation or Union in Kansas City, and they made arrangements for a Danish band representing the spirit, you would say, maybe, of Ben Webster to come to Kansas City to experience a part of the U.S. and the U.S. jazz scene that none of us, at least, had ever been to or seen, and vice versa for the Kansas City musicians and audience to hear and meet a Danish jazz group.
Wonderful, man. So talk to me about where you grew up and how you got involved with jazz.
I grew up in Norway, actually, on the west coast, in a small, typical smallville Norway, desolate place. Both my parents are classical musicians, but they would always listen to all kinds of music. And actually, I wanted to play guitar. Guns N' Roses was the big thing that summer, so everybody wanted to play guitar. So there were no slots left at the at the music school for guitar lessons. So they said, how about the drums? Nobody wants to play the drums these days. So I thought I would do that for a year and then head for the guitar, but then it was love at first sight with the drums.
Wonderful. What jazz music did you listen to in the beginning that really motivated you?
The first things, I mean, my parents would, they were very, very helpful because they came from such a musical background. They would find things of quality for me to listen to since I was interested in jazz for unknown reasons from the start. So, but one of the first things that got me was some things with Gene Krupa, who was my first childhood idol, I suppose, and a lot of music from the same period, a lot of 40s and 50s swing related stuff, I would guess.
So you kind of, how did you get your start in music? I mean, was the stage always kind of, did you always know that you were going to be a professional musician? How did that begin for you?
Very early, actually. I played my, also by chance, I played, somehow managed to get a gig after having played just drums for a year for a Christmas jazz show with a local theater group with not professional but seasoned amateurs in the of the good class within the jazz thing, and I knew instantly that, man, that was the thing. It was just fantastic getting to play live, and I mean, even getting paid at 10, that was fantastic.
Right on. Were you nervous on stage, or has it always been kind of a second home, a natural place for you?
It's always been a second home. I think I was nervous in the beginning, of course, but never in a destructive way, more in like a stage jitters kind of let's do it kind of way.
Sure.
I would say.
So your bio says that you skyrocketed onto the European jazz scene as a sideman. And I want to know, what does that mean? Did it all happen so fast?
Well, first and foremost, I think that's very much the way my record company press secretary likes to state that. I'm not sure I would say I skyrocketed, but during my years of study at the conservatory in Copenhagen, I've worked a lot and more, and I suppose I was... had a chance to play with some of the biggest Scandinavian names, at least very early on in my studying years. But to be honest, it's really press talk.
Yeah, I get it.
The way of putting that.
With your 2012 debut, Blues Modernism, you won Album of the Year in Denmark. But beyond that, it had to be a relief to finally have your first album out and to have people really respond well to it. How did that feel?
Felt fantastic. I'm very, but also at the same time, it's at least for me, I didn't know that before having done it. But once you release something under your own name, you're also it doesn't take long for critics and for the audiences to put you in a box. This is this guy. He does only does that thing, and also actually for other musicians too. So. But overall, it's just been fun, and I, for at least, I've learned a lot from it, and in just also in terms of how to be a sideman for other band leaders too. Once you learn what a hassle it is to get everything in order as a band leader.
Absolutely. So, are you happy with where your career is right now, with how everything is stacked up and what's going on?
I am. I think it's fantastic, and I'm very excited that in 2019 people are still listening to this kind of jazz music, and we're getting a very positive response everywhere we go, and both with the older audiences, but also with the younger ones. So it feels good, and it's I feel very fortunate to do that on a full-time basis.
What was one of the first live jazz shows you saw that really impressed you?
I saw a lot of things with the local musicians where I grew up, because it's so, I mean, even within Norway, it's pretty far away from also the capital, which is the only place where you'll get international names in Norway. I think some of the first live gigs I saw, that was probably when I was around a teenager, 14 or 15, we had some of the great, you know, 90s fusion guys stopped by Norway, like Dave Weckl played in my hometown, I remember. That was a big thing back then, so a bit of stuff like that.
Why do you love jazz?
A lot of reasons, but I love the sense of community that's in it, and the at least with the kind of jazz that I play with my band, that it is a... It can't function without everybody cooperating when swing is involved. It's such a physical and such a group mentality that's involved in it, which is fantastic. It's just like playing the perfect ball game or having a great night in every way when it's working.
Let's say you come to Kansas City, you play at one of our bigger clubs, and you have to come up with a way to describe what your show would be like. How would you do that to get people to come see you?
That's a good question. I would say it's music that will sound both familiar for the jazz, especially for the classic jazz fan, but it's also, or I hope it is, it's my belief and wish that it's also contemporary at the same time while building on that tradition. We had a radio presenter in Germany was I think he summed it up pretty well. He said to us after a show that it was like hearing Duke Ellington with Wi-Fi.
That's beautiful. I think that really wraps up and sums up what I was looking for. Thank you for taking a minute out to talk about the new music, your Kansas City links, and your life in jazz. I appreciate it.
Man, thank you so much. It's fantastic. I mean, I love this kind of strange connection with Kansas City.
Yeah.
On our part. I hope we'll get to return sometime and play again. That would be fantastic.
Thanks for listening and tuning in to another Neon Jazz interview, where we give you a bit of insight into the finest cats in Denmark, Europe, Kansas City, and spots all over the world giving fans all that jazz. And thanks to Snore for his time, honesty, and music. If you want to hear more interviews, go to Famous Interviews with Joe Devino in the iTunes Store. Visit NeonJazz at YouTube.com, and for everything Neon Jazz all the time, visit theneonjazz.blogspot.com. Until next time, enjoy the jazz, my friends.
Neon Jazz.